Hello, my dear students. So in my last class, I was explaining about the periodic properties. We started with the new chapter. So there we understood what is a periodic table. So a table in which elements are arranged in the order of increasing atomic number in the manner that the elements with similar properties fall in the same vertical column. So that was known as the periodic table. And mainly we concentrated on 5 important periodic properties. So that was first one, atomic radius, second, ionization energy, third, electron affinity, fourth, electronegativity, and the fifth is a metallic character. Okay. So in my previous class, so we understood what is atomic radius. And to understand this atomic radius, we introduced 3 different radii, that is 3 other radii were introduced. So those 3 were covalent radius, van der Waals radius, and ionic radius. With the help of these 3 radii, we can calculate or we can understand the atomic radius. And also the determination of atomic size by Landes method was understood in my previous session. So in this class, so let us concentrate on another 3 important periodic properties, that is ionization energy, electron affinity, and electronegativity. So what is meant by ionization energy? Ionization energy, in simple terms, it can be described as a measure of the difficulty in removing an electron from an atom or ion, or the tendency of an atom or ion to surrender an electron. The loss of electron usually happens in the ground state of the chemical species. So ionization energy can be defined as the amount of energy required to remove the outermost electron from an isolated neutral gaseous atom. Say for example, a metal which is in a gaseous form. So when it collides or combines with an energy, so it is going to leave an electron. This is a common phenomena. When a radiation or when a heat energy falls upon any metal or any object or substance, so it is going to lose an electron. So when it loses an electron, so how much of energy has been required to remove the outermost electron from that particular isolated neutral gaseous atom, so that energy is called as ionization energy. The energy required to remove the outermost electron from a neutral gaseous atom is known as first ionization energy, and it is represented as IE1. Okay, so the electron which is present in the outermost shell, so how much of energy has been utilized or used to remove that electron, so that energy is called as first ionization energy. And IE2 and IE3, IE4, like this. So the energies which is needed to remove an electron from the unipositive and dipositive cations respectively is termed as IE2, IE3. After the removal of outermost electron, what happens? So the size of the atom is going to decrease. Okay, so this is quite common. When the outermost electron is removed, so definitely the size of the electron or the size is going to decrease, size of the atom is going to get decreased, and in turn the effective nuclear charge increases. The nucleus holds the rest of the electrons more tightly, so this is the reason why the effective nuclear charge is going to increase. As the energy or the size of the atom decreases, the effective nuclear charge is going to increase. Removal of electron from unipositive ion requires more energy. So IE2 and IE3 etc. are more than the IE1. That is, the ionization energy, the first ionization energy is it requires more energy than the IE2 and IE3. Hence, we can write it as IE1 is lesser than IE2 is lesser than IE3. So, in this way, we can represent the ionization energy. So, as I said, so this is a metal, gaseous metal atom. So, when it combines with the energy, so it is going to lose an electron. Okay, so here the electron has been liberated or separated out. And how much energy is required for this purpose? So, that is called as ionization energy. Now, let us understand the determination of ionization energy by discharge tube method. So, in discharge tube method, so what we are going to do is, we are going to use the electrically heated tungsten wire. So, this is a common phenomenon. When the electrically heated tungsten wire emits electrons, so the grid can be charged positively for different voltages. Okay, so we are going to insert a tungsten metal in a discharge tube. So let us imagine, so this is a discharge tube, and here so a tungsten metal has been placed. So this tungsten metal, so one side it will be positively charged, and another is a negatively charged plate. So in between this, a positively charged grid has been placed. The plate opposite to the grid has small negative charge. When the potential on the grid is zero, that means no current flows between grid and the plate. Okay, so in this stage, when the potential of the grid is zero, that means that so there is no current is flowing between grid and the plate. If the grid is charged by sufficient potential, then the electrons are emitted by the tungsten wire and accelerated towards the grid. Okay, so here when it is heated, so what happens from this tungsten wire, so the electrons are going to emit, and this will accelerate towards this grid, that is the positively charged grid. The electrons are passed through the grid and ionized atoms present between the grid and the plate. The electrons ejected by the by each atom are attracted towards the plate. Thus, a current passes between grid and a plate, which is shown up by the ammeter. So, it will be, the whole setup will be connected with the ammeter. So, this ammeter, it measures the current which passes between grid and plate. Okay. So, this is how we are going to perform the experiment to determine the ionization energy by discharge tube method. Okay, so these are the explanations what I have already explained. That is, the plate opposite to the grid has a small negative charge. When the potential on the grid is zero, no current flows between grid and the plate. If the grid is charged by sufficient potential, then electrons are emitted by the tungsten wire and accelerated towards the grid. The electrons are passed through the grid and ionized atoms present between the grid and the plate. And the current passes between grid and the plate, which is shown up by ammeter. The minimum grid voltage that produces the sudden rise in the current is called ionization potential, and it is represented as V. So, ionization energy is equals to V, that is ionization potential, into charge of electron into Avogadro number. So if we simplify this, so then we are going to get the ionization energy. That means how much of energy has been required to remove the outermost electron from an isolated neutral gaseous atom can be calculated. So here V is ionization potential, as I said. So if we know the ionization potential, how we will come to know the ionization potential? So that is ionization potential is nothing but the minimum grid voltage that produces the sudden rise in the current. Okay, so that we will find out by doing the experiment using a discharge tube. And charge of electron is that is constant. that is 1.609 into 10 raised to minus 19, and Avogadro's number, we know that 6.023 into 10 raised to 23. So with this equation, or with this simple calculation, so we can find out the ionization energy of that particular electron. Okay, next is about electron affinity. So it is the amount of energy released when an electron is added to an isolated neutral gaseous atom. So this is just reverse of ionization energy. Electron affinity is a reverse of ionization energy. That means, so electron affinity defines that the amount of energy released when an electron is added to an isolated neutral gaseous atom. Okay, so it is not easy to add an electron to an isolated neutral gaseous atom. Suppose if that gaseous atom is in this state, that is, if it has a positive charge by losing an electron, then it attracts the electron and easily it will get into a stable state. Whereas for an isolated neutral gaseous atom, it is difficult to add an electron. So it requires certain amount of energy. So that amount of energy, how much amount of energy is released when an electron is added to an isolated neutral gaseous atom is called as electron affinity. Say for example, so here X is a isolated gaseous or neutral gaseous atom, X is a neutral gaseous atom, and to this electron has been added. So that means when this electron is going to add to this neutral gaseous atom, there is an amount of energy released. So that measures electron affinity. So how we are going to determine the electron affinity? So to determine electron affinity, so we use a Born-Haber's cycle. What is meant by a Born-Haber cycle? So let us understand that. When a metal atom in the solid state combines with another atom in a gaseous state, a compound in the solid state is obtained, and in this process some energy is released. Okay, so imagine a metal atom which is in a solid state, it is going to combine with another metal atom, so which will be in a gaseous state, and the product which is obtained will be a solid product. And in this particular reaction or process, some energy is released. So this energy which is released is called as heat of formation, because the products have been formed here. So the products are formed. During the formation of products, certain amount of energy is released. So that energy is called as heat of formation, and it is represented as delta HF. Since the reaction is exothermic, the energy is indicated by negative sign. So always, so if the reaction is exothermic, we use a negative sign. If the reaction is endothermic, we use a positive sign. Okay, so that means energy is released, energy has been lost, so that is why negative sign. When it is gained, when energy is gained, when it is an endothermic reaction, so then we use positive, that means it has absorbed, it has gained, so that is why a positive sign. Say for example, so M, when it combines with another gaseous atom, so X2, so MX is the product which is formed, which will be in a solid state, and in this heat is released. So that is why, so delta HF will be a positive. I have called this equation as equation number 1. And the value of delta HF can be calculated. The above reaction can also take place by the following steps. So this is one reaction. So there are many steps which follows to this product to form. Okay, so this is a multi-step. We can explain the formation of heat of formation, that is delta HF, in various different steps. So let us see one by one. So solid metal atom, that is MS, absorbs energy which is equal to its sublimation energy. That is, sublimation energy is represented as delta Hs, and it gets changed into gaseous metal atom. So initially, so what is meant by sublimation? So direct transfer from solid to gaseous. Okay, so there is no liquid state absorbed. So this solid metal, when it absorbs an energy which is equal to its sublimation energy, it changes its state, that is, solid is going to change into a gaseous metal atom. Okay, and this is an endothermic reaction. That means here energy is absorbed, that is delta Hs. So this is delta Hs is equals to positive. And in the second step, gaseous metal, after the formation of gaseous metal atom obtained in step A, absorbs energy which is equal to ionization energy, and it is converted into gaseous metal atom or cation. Okay, so gaseous metal cation, it is going to convert into gaseous metal cation, and in this reaction one electron is lost by metal which is in the gaseous state. Okay, electron is lost, and this is also endothermic reaction. That means energy is absorbed, and that energy which has been absorbed, so that is ionization energy. And in the third step, so half a molecule of X2, it absorbs energy which is equal to half of the dissociation energy of X2 molecule, and it is converted into gaseous X atom. And this is also an endothermic reaction, and this is called as dissociation energy, that especially half of the dissociation energy. So here the heat absorbed is endothermic, and it is called as half of the dissociation energy. And in the fourth step, so this metal or an atom which is in the gaseous state, it is obtained as above accepts an electron which is lost by a metal in the step B, and it is converted into gaseous X ion. The energy released will be equal to its electron affinity. Okay, so the energy released is equals to the electron affinity. Now the metal cation, okay, so this is metal cation which is present, and the metal anion, so they both combine together and produce Mx. So in this combination process, energy equal to lattice energy of Mx, and it is represented as capital letter U, and that capital letter U is nothing but lattice energy. Okay, on adding equations A, B, C, D and E. Okay, so I can't show you what are those equations, you just go through in your textbook. On adding equations A, B, C, D and E, so we get equation 1, that is, so a metal which is in a solid state, it combines with half of the molecule or which absorbs the energy which is equal to half of the dissociation energy of X2. Okay, and the product which is formed will be Mx. Okay, therefore delta Hf is equals to sum up all the equations or all the energy which has been absorbed, the heat absorbed or the energy released. So sum up all, that is delta Hf is equals to delta Hs plus IE, that is ionization energy. Okay, so what are these? So what is meant by delta Hs? So delta Hs is nothing but so it is a sublimation energy. Okay, so delta Hs, sublimation energy plus ionization energy plus half of the dissociation energy of X2 plus electron affinity plus lattice energy. So by adding all these energies which has been absorbed or released during the process of formation of the product, gives us the electron affinity of an atom. Okay, so in this way, so we can calculate the electron affinity of an atom with the help of Born-Haber's cycle. So the various steps given above means or the various steps explained till now. So all these can be represented in the form of a cycle, which is known as Born-Haber cycle. Okay, so this is Born-Haber's cycle. If you go through this, so every step is clearly represented in this cycle. Okay, so this is the first reaction. So that is a heat of formation, delta HF. Okay, so for this product to form, so there are many different steps, that is sublimation energy, ionization energy, half of the dissociation energy of X2, and electron affinity, and finally the lattice energy. Okay, so during the formation of all these steps, so the energy is released or energy is absorbed, and all constituently forms the final product. Okay, so this is how we are going to understand Born-Haber's cycle. And next is electronegativity. What is meant by electronegativity? The relative tendency of a bonded atom in a molecule to attract shared pair of electrons towards itself is termed as electronegativity. That means, so how it is going to show the relative tendency to attract the pair of electrons towards itself? So it is termed as electronegativity. So electronegativity is a very important topic or very important thing which we have to understand in the periodic properties. That is because the tendency of an atom in a molecule to attract the shared pair of electrons towards itself is known as electronegativity, as I said, and it is a dimensionless property. Electronegativity is a dimensionless property because it is only a tendency. It basically indicates the net result of the tendencies of the atoms in different elements to attract the bond forming electron pairs. So in the periodic table, if we observe, there is a trend in the electronegativities of elements. As we move across a period from left to right, the nuclear charge increases and the atomic size decreases. Therefore, the value of electronegativity increases across a period in the modern periodic table. For example, so the electronegativity trend across period 3 in the periodic table is clearly understood. That means sodium, magnesium, aluminium, silicon, phosphorus, sulfur, chlorine, if you see that, okay, so if you observe a periodic table, so that especially across a period period 3, so we can see the increase in the electronegativity. Okay, so what is meant by electronegativity? So electronegativity is nothing but the relative tendency of a bonded atom in a molecule to attract shared pair of electrons towards itself is termed as electronegativity. Usually, the determination of electronegativity is done by two different scales, that is Pauling scale and Mulliken scale. So what is meant by Pauling scale? So the Pauling scale of electronegativity is given by XA minus XB is equals to 0.089 to the square root of delta. So here root delta is expressed in terms of kilojoules per mole. Okay, so this is kilojoules per mole. So what is delta here? So delta is equals to E A minus B minus E A minus A into E B minus B to the whole power of into half. Okay, so what are these terms? Let us see here. So here XA, so this one XA is electronegativity of A, XB is electronegativity of B, E A minus B, so this one E A minus B means dissociation energy of A minus B bond. Okay, so or this A minus B, or it could be understood as a bond between A and B. Okay, so E A and B is nothing but dissociation energy of A and B bond. EAA means dissociation energy of A2. A2 is a molecule, A is an atom. Okay, so here two atoms are there, so two atoms forms a molecule. And next EBB is nothing but dissociation energy of a B2 molecule. Okay, so B2 is a molecule. So by using this equation, if the electronegativity of one atom is known, then electronegativity of the other can be calculated. Next is the Mulliken scale. According to Mulliken, electronegativity is the average of ionization energy and electron affinity of an atom. Okay, so this is given by XA is equals to 0.374 into ionization energy plus electron affinity divided by 2 plus 0.17. So if we simplify this, okay, so that means so here 0.374 has been simplified, so 0.187 into ionization energy plus electron affinity plus 0.17, where XA is the electronegativity of atom, IE and EA are measured. IE means ionization energy and electron affinity are measured in electron volts. Okay, so this is how we can determine the electronegativity by either Pauling scale or Mulliken scale. Okay, so I am going to stop it here. So in my next class, we will see applications of periodic properties. Thank you, dear students.